Hi, I'm here with John Hunter, who is the author of Management Managers, Building Enterprise Capability, a book on Leanpub. We're going to talk today about John's book, about John's experiences as an author, and what led John to try Lean Publishing with Leanpub. So John, thank you for being on the Lean Publishing podcast.
Thank you for having me. I look forward to it.
Great. So before we start discussing your book and Lean Publishing, I'd like to find out a little bit more about you and your background. So if you could tell me a little bit about what you do and whether you've published a book before, things like that.
Okay. I have not published a book before. Real quick view of my background is I'm actually right now, the closest thing you could call it is a sabbatical, but it's not actually a sabbatical, but that's the closest thing I can come up with. I'm in Johor Bahru, Malaysia. And as I sit in my condo, I see Singapore out my window. And when I was a little kid, my dad actually was teaching in Singapore, and we were living there. And he was teaching on the stuff that I basically now do, which is management improvement and helping organizations improve their management and improve their results. And through that's basically what my career path has been about. Over time, I moved into doing technology, largely because I was frustrated with the technology departments I would need to get service from, and I found it easier to do the things myself. Huh. And then I eventually moved into being in those departments.
Okay, have you worked as a consultant then, or were you working within the department itself when you were doing this kind of work?
So sort of both.
Okay.
During my career, I started out, I was doing it myself, and I was somewhat doing it in a consulting relationship, because my official duty, I was doing things outside of my official duties and helping other parts of the organization. Then I went to the Office of Secretary of Defense Quality Management Office, where we would largely help the huge Department of Defense get things done with consultants, and we would do some consulting along those lines.
Quite a challenge, I imagine, the Defense Department.
Yes, it's huge. It's enormous. It's impossible to appreciate, but they did lots of great stuff. They're huge. Mm-hmm. Then I went to the White House Military Office for a few years, and then I went to the American Society for Engineering Education. And now what I'm doing, during that time, I did a little bit of consulting outside and some seminars and talking. And now my sabbatical, the other thing you could say, I'm doing some consulting and some seminars and some writing.
Okay.
During this time. So.
Okay. So sounds like you've had a wide range of experience all around the world. Can you tell me then a little bit more or a little bit about the subject of your book, Management Matters, and what you're addressing in it?
Yeah, the book is my look at a system of management. So I have a blog that I've been publishing for 7 or 8 years. And one of the troubles I have when I'm trying to write a post is I have all sorts of connections that I want to make. And so I love hypertext because I can link over to all these things.
Mm-hmm.
But my plan was actually to write a specific book on a specific tool or practice, because I figured that would be small, a good place to start. It would be targeted, and it would probably be easier to market. But I thought about it, and I could never get myself started. And one day I decided I really need this full management view that I can then stick everything else to. So then if I write a second, most likely smaller targeted book, I can refer to this for how it fits into the bigger context. So that's my goal with this, is to try to have a book that has management as a system.
Management as a system. So your ideal reader would be, say, people who are already working as managers and have some training in that field, or them and also people who are new to management?
So this is one of the problems with the marketing of this particular book compared to my other ones, is I don't have the specific answer to that. I think you're sort of right that it would be that. But it's really people who want to improve results. And so one of the thing that I've found is software developers have by far the most success with the thinking that I have, the thinking that Deming had with process improvement, with systems thinking of anyone I've worked with, much better than managers overall. Well, the truth is that like software developers could very well be a better target audience in that they'll be able to pick it up more easily, I think, than many managers. But anyway, sorry.
Okay, no, that's great. So on that note, you mentioned Deming, and I know the theories of William Edwards Deming play a big role in your book. Can you tell us something more about him and why his work is so important to you?
Yeah, I was talking a little earlier about living in Singapore. We also lived a year in Nigeria another time. And one of the things I write the W. Edwards Deming Institute blog. And the first post I did on that blog, I talked about Deming's background and what I see as very important that I think a lot of people miss. And that is that he grew up, he was born in 1900. There's World War I, the Great Depression, World War II, and then post-World War II recovery in Japan.
Right, right.
That was a bunch of bad stuff. He also traveled extensively throughout the world, so he was in Asia and other places. As I grew up, I saw that firsthand that there was a lot of people that were not nearly as rich as pretty much everyone in the United States.
Right.
And what Deming had as his personal vision was to foster prosperity, commerce, and peace. And I have that same notion. What is needed for improvement of humanity's life is commerce and prosperity. Most people who are interested.
I've read a little bit about Deming in the last few days in preparation for the interview, and I came across a great line which said something like, although Deming is something of a hero in Japan, he's still in some ways obscure in the rest of the world, including the United States. And I was wondering if you could tell me a little bit more just about what he achieved in post-war Japan and what he's famous for there.
Well, that's a difficult question to summarize quickly.
Okay.
But essentially, he went there and helped them understand how to look at the organization as a system. The biggest example of sort of Deming's ideas are Toyota. So Deming's ideas are not very prescriptive.
Okay.
He has a system of thinking, a system of management, but it's not prescriptive of you must do X, Y, and Z.
And he was behind a lot of the improvements to manufacturing processes that Toyota is so famous for now.
Yeah. So what Toyota did was they took his ideas and they did what Deming wants, which is you take the ideas, you institute them in your organization. Inside your organization, there are specific adaptions and improvements that you'll make that work best for you. So Toyota took the base and then added to it.
Okay. To go back to before I interrupted you to get a little bit more detail about Deming, you were talking about your idea that increasing commerce increases sort of prosperity and the human good, and was this also an idea of Deming's that you've developed further or carried on in the tradition of, as it were?
Yeah. And it's also something that Deming didn't talk as much about. I mean, Deming had the idea of commerce, prosperity, and peace, but, you know, mostly he talked about, you know, what we can do for your organization. But I think behind him was this idea that he saw all these suffering people throughout his whole life. Mm-hmm. And he saw that what was needed was prosperity. You have, when I was growing up, billions of people who don't have electricity, billions of people who don't have running water, billions of people who don't have, you know, a secure future. It's not some minor little thing. And what they need is prosperity. That's what's going to make it so that everyone's doing better. And it's happened in the last 40 years. There's been a lot of improvement, but there's still a lot more to go. It's hard for people in the United States or even in Europe to understand that prosperity is not about, you know, having the fourth new car in most of the world. Prosperity is about having, you know, shoes.
Right.
Those are different ideas.
Right. That reminds me of an interesting article in The Economist recently in which they talked about this worry that there's an end to innovation coming. And they, in particular, seem to define innovation as adding new things. You know, there will never be another invention as fundamental as the toilet. And so we're kind of at the end of progress. But what you're saying reminds me that this is a very kind of, as it were, prosperity world-centric point of view, because there are still a lot of people who don't have toilets, even though they have been invented.
Right. Yeah. Hundreds of millions.
Yes, yes. And so,
minor little numbers.
So from their perspective, as it were, you know, until, and I guess to tie it into what you're saying, what's at stake for you in management and improving management isn't, as it were, only improving the functioning of businesses in order to make more money, but actually fundamentally improving the world. And that kind of innovation is something that we're still, you know, in the dark on and need to improve dramatically.
Yeah, one of the things that I really like and my father was involved in is appropriate technology. Talking about technology that really works where it's needed, which is very similar to the whole lean way of thinking of, you know, you don't need some big complex solution. You can find the simplest solution that works and is reliable. And so I continue to do work there. Another way that this ties is a lot of people think of Deming as sort of a statistician, which he was. But his management system uses statistics, but that is far from the core piece or the central piece. It's one piece. A huge portion of Deming's management system is what he called understanding psychology, and it relates to psychology, but it really relates to managing human systems. And in the lean thinking world, they essentially call this respect for people, which I think gives a better, more power than just saying psychology. Deming would also talk about joy in work.
Right. Can you tell me a little bit more about that? I was interested in your book where you write about the importance of respecting people in the workplace as good strategy.
So if you look at the bigger picture of what Deming is trying to do, I think there's a lot of it of what I was talking about, increasing prosperity. Another piece of it is in the United States, we were extremely prosperous, but people were by and large miserable in their jobs. And to some extent, that's still true. And respect for people is about the idea that our focus needs to change to having people enjoy their lives. And this will benefit all of us who have our lives to live. But it also benefits the organization. It's very easy for knowledge workers to think this way. So in the software development workforce or in the medical workforce or in the engineering workforce, the workers demand it. If you try to treat your Ruby developers poorly, they'll leave.
Right.
There's no question. So in large part, you give them foosball tables and you let them bring their dogs to work and you let them do whatever they want.
Right.
I think most of the managers that allow that to happen are not necessarily doing it because they believe in the intrinsic goodness of treating people well. They do it because they can't figure out how not to do it. But there are the segment of people who manage knowledge workers well who understand that this is how you get the best work. One of the things that I'll do on my blog is I'll put a post where I can draw links to more detail on a bunch of things that I say, but there's a lot of work on it. Daniel Pink is very popular right now, and you know, he talks about it. Clayton Christensen is very popular.
But can you tell me a little bit more about your blog, the Curious Cat Management Improvement blog? I seem to remember you started that, or you had your first website in 1995, and your blog has been going for almost 10 years now?
Yeah, the website was 1995, right. And then I started the blog in 2004.
Okay.
And the blog is on my ideas on management, and it is what sort of formed the basis of the book. One of the nice things I was able to do was import my blog into Leanpub as the start of the book. So what I was able to do was to take all the blog posts into the book, and then there are a bunch that don't really relate, you know, that are sort of off the cuff sort of comments. So get rid of those and organize it into the something that makes sense for a book. But that formed probably a basis of 50 or 60% of the book that then I had to build on.
Okay.
So the blog is largely about the same thing as the book.
Okay. And did you find that going through that process focused your mind on your work at a higher level when you had to kind of curate your posts and see, you know, what have I actually been writing about?
Yeah, well, the reason I wanted to do it and the thing that it did require was that focus on the system of how everything ties together. So I would do that a lot, and I use far more hyperlinks than almost anyone I know because I'm trying to link all these things together. Mm-hmm. But I knew that in writing the book that would be, because that's the focus, is how these things all link together,
right,
and sort
right.
of curating that and making that work. And then writing all the pieces, there are big sections which I've thought about writing for the last several years, but I just can't get my head around for a blog post. So
right.
then I had to do that stuff, which is generally harder and more complex,
right?
And write that. So yeah, that made you focus and think about it more.
Okay, before we go on, I'd like to talk, obviously I'd like to talk about this more maybe in the second half of the podcast about using Leanpub and what brought you to it and what worked for you and what didn't. But I do have one question I'm very interested in asking you about, which is that in your book you talk about how executive pay is a big problem today. And I know you've been asked about this in another podcast recently, but I would like to know what solution you propose to the problem of executive pay that's too high. Do you think shareholder activists will take care of it, or should there be explicit regulation?
Well, my solution is not a answer separated from all the other factors in the system. So I think if we say, take the broken system that we have and, you know, all of these broken pieces, and what can we do to make that work? What Band-Aid can we put on there and have it stick? I don't think any Band-Aid is going to be particularly effective, and any Band-Aid, given all the other factors, will cause huge problems. So,
okay.
It is a solution that requires many more underlying things, but I think part of it has to do, my solutions would be, yeah, probably have some regulation around the deductibility of bonuses, and have some, but I think a bunch of it would come down to more moral and ethical pressure on organizations so that it's just not tolerated. I mean, one of the things that I find frustrating is these people who choose these policies that are not high. This high pay is one thing, but they also do things like risk the future of the company in order to get high bonuses.
Right.
And then when it fails,
right.
thousands
right.
of people lose their jobs.
Right.
When that happens, that person still has $40 million sitting in the bank. They give $2 million to Stanford or some other school, and then that school gives them publicity and, you know, puts their name on a building or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
The school that I went to, Davidson College in North Carolina, has an honor code. And those kinds of things would just not be tolerated. You can't you know, make a huge amount of money from unethical behavior and then buy your way onto boards and buy your way into country clubs and buy your way onto, you know, the opera board, people should not accept unethical behavior by rewarding it with all sorts of accolades outside.
I think I see more clearly what you were saying before then, when it's a society that's rewarding this kind of behavior that is part of the problem. And so merely changing some laws around or rules around particular organizations won't change that underlying factor.
Yeah. One of the hopes I have on how things will change is if other countries can withstand the pressure that U.S. and U.S. business schools are putting on moving in this direction, which I think is wrong, because they don't ridiculously overpay their executives. They still pay them a lot of money, but the top 20 executives at Toyota together don't make what senior vice presidents at the large U.S. firms.
Including options?
Yes, including options and everything, because they don't really give that many options.
And do they have you know, golden parachute? Do you think that's largely an American phenomenon as well, and perhaps British? Okay.
No, basically what's happened is a lot of these things are American, and the thing is that in 1980 executives were paid a ton of money, and it was there'd be plenty of people who were complaining against it. People like Drucker said, look. At least a little bit before 1980, said, look, the executives deserve a lot of money. They have hard jobs. They do things. They make a difference. They should be paid a lot of money. But as the abuses got so ridiculous, Drucker said, this has to stop. It's bad. It got to the point where Drucker said, this is unethical. I can't remember if he said it's immoral, but he came pretty close.
So we're talking about Peter Drucker, the famous management guru.
Yeah. And it wasn't that he's, you know, against them paying a fair wage. He supported it when it was reasonable. It got to be so bad. But we've gone 10 or 20 times beyond that, beyond what was already not just bad, you know, management, unethical. And it's just it's not just that they're taking money that belongs to someone else. It's that they subvert the organization in order to have this happen. They take huge risks that then everyone else must pay for. And if it doesn't work out, well, fine. They still walk away with a huge amount of money. And if it does work out, then they say, well, I deserve this huge amount of money because I was successful. It comes back to one of the big pieces that I have is that you have to build up the capacity in the organization for critical thinking. And part of my idea, the reason why I've come to the last 5 or 6 years building enterprise capability as the key, is it isn't about what we can do in one day, but it's what we do over the long term. And so when I'm looking at how we need to improve today, I'm not just paying attention to this one project is going to solve this problem and be very effective. I'm looking at this. By the way that I can solve this problem, I can build in this organization understanding of critical thinking. I can build an understanding of variation. I can build an understanding that the results are not the only thing that matters. Results matter, but results matter within a context.
And do you see any movement towards these kinds of ideas in management schools or management programs in the United States?
I haven't paid much attention to management schools, but they weren't very good before. I don't think they've gotten tremendously better. There are tons of professors who have great ideas, but the focus ends up being on essentially financial management and working with spreadsheets, and the rest of it is not given much focus.
I see. So sort of getting people away from the spreadsheet is part of your idea. And what would it?
Or it, yes.
Well, just but, no, I know it's kind of tongue in cheek, but what else would do you think people should be focusing on?
Well, with the spreadsheet, it would be twofold. One, yeah, getting them away from it, but two, having them actually understand data, instead of being able to be fooled by people that can manipulate data.
Right.
Building this capacity for critical thinking, building the ability to understand what is actually a cause and what is just correlated to good results. That's one of the big keys. So in Deming, it was understanding variation, which is important. Understanding that results vary, and humans, this goes to the psychology piece from Deming, humans happen to think that there's a lot less variation than there is in the world. And humans happen to have brains that were evolved for pattern matching. So we're very good at seeing patterns. So we think that there's less variation. Our brains can see patterns, so we can find variation that exists in the data, and we can then tie that to some cause that we believe is there. So our pattern, our brains can create this pattern. And what we do is we believe all sorts of things that just are not true because we don't understand how to accurately interpret the data.
So if you were brought into a corporation, say, and you were given an opportunity, let's say you had your own office or budget in order to try and make this a reality within that organization, how would you go about doing it? Would you set up courses internally for employees? Would you try and fundamentally change the way they interact with data?
I'm a bit different in my style of change from most people. I talk about some things in the book, but my basic idea is building the capability in the organization. So it isn't mainly about what's the rollout plan or anything else, but
okay,
it's what do we have today? Where can I see to build things? So do we have a somewhat good understanding of data, and I can build on that to make things stronger? Do we have a culture that totally disrespects the employees, and we need to change that before we can move forward? So basically what I would do is I would look at the organization. I would see where there are points that are I have specific things where I talk about all the details, but where there are points that people very much care about, because you need it to be things that people will notice. And also at the very beginning, I pick things that I know that I believe I can win on. You know, you need to build some trust that this stuff works before you can keep growing, and especially do some of the things that don't have as direct ties that you can see. So I would take the projects, I would take the things that people really care about, I would take the opportunities, and if, you know, it might be that it's training these people on design of experiments and having us do some design of experiments and make that a focus for a while. One of the things I talk about is I think the key is to have some focus with your initial efforts. So there's lots of things you can do. Depending on the organization, you know, pick 5 or 6 things and really get to be really good at those 5 or 6 things, and then keep adding in a few more pieces over time.
Okay. Just before we move on to the second part of the interview, where I'd like to ask you, I'm really interested in what your experience transforming your blog into a book and adding content. But I do have one final question. You mentioned experiments. And I think that for people who are familiar with, Steve Blank and lean philosophy and things like that, the idea of running experiments within an enterprise might be familiar, but it might not be to everybody. Can you give me an example of what you mean by doing experiments in that context?
Yeah, one of the things is I believe that most of these good ideas have been talked about for a long time by people like Deming and Acuff and others. And so the basic core idea is you pilot an improvement, or you pilot a change in a small scale, you get results, you see how it worked, and then you expand. And a neat way that that's been talked about recently, especially with all the software people, is sort of minimum viable product and fail quickly. It's wonderful. It's sort of like what Toyota did with Deming's ideas, in my opinion. It's taking the basic core idea, which has been around for a long time, and giving some really nice implementation to it that adds value.
So, for example, an example might be, we want to improve the quality of our you know, dashboards or something like that. And so let's actually implement a change clearly in one place, and then actually set targets and watch to see what the results are, to see if our idea actually worked. Is that an example of what you mean by experimenting?
Yes, although I believe that a big, huge strength with agile software development is get working software in place quickly.
Right.
I totally and completely support that idea.
Right.
The quibble that I have with where a lot of this stuff ends up going is people try to make it too measurable. And sometimes it is. It's very easy for companies like Google and Amazon to make things measurable because they have, you know, millions of users. You can see what goes on.
Right.
When you have a lot smaller organizations, there's huge amounts of variation. And
right.
If you're totally focused on the data, numerical data, and that's the only way you're going to judge things, I think that can cause problems. But the basic core idea, I totally agree with. Get a working model in place. Have people actually using it. Have people tell you what they miss about, you know, it's like, okay, this is great, except it kills me that this one feature is missing. And if, you know, 50 people say that, it's like, okay, we better build that one next feature.
Well, so I think that's a great transition to the second part of this interview, where we're going to carry out that process, I guess, in the unity of form and content here. So I was wondering if we could talk a bit about what it's been like for you using Leanpub as an author and indeed a first-time book author. And what do you really like about Leanpub, and what we could do to improve it?
Yeah, I had no interest in the traditional publishing method for several reasons. One, my personality is one where it's very difficult for me to finalize and ship something off. One of the reasons I like this continual improvement idea, which, you know, is a central idea for Deming, is that fits with my personality. I think things should always be continuously improved. My entry into technology world was essentially with web-based apps, even if they were internal to the organization, so they were on an intranet, but, you know, they're basically web technologies, where you didn't have this release thing of sending out a disk. And it's like, now we've locked our software in place.
Right,
So I've never had to have this idea that, okay, I'm done, print it. So I didn't want it for that reason. Also, I'm a first-time publisher. I don't know why anyone, I don't know anyone would want to publish me, but I know plenty of very successful business and management improvement type authors, and the troubles that they get from their publishers. It's ridiculous. The lead time that it takes to get stuff done.
Right.
So I had no interest in that.
Right.
So for an ebook, I looked around, and like I said, I was sort of, for a couple years, I was throwing the ideas around in my head and trying to see where to go, and I would look at what options there were. And I found Leanpub, and I liked it, and I, you know, had looked at some other ones. But the one of the things that I really liked about it was not specific features or specific anything.
Right.
It was, they used Lean in the name, but they also had actual Lean thinking behind what they were talking about.
Right.
So I saw that, look, they have the mentality that matches my mentality. And I think it's an effective and good way to manage. I want to be associated with organizations
That's very interesting. Yeah, you say, the ability to continuously deploy, as it were, your book both fits with your needs, which is to get your work out there without having to go through the titanic struggles that authors sometimes engage with publishers, but it also suits your personality, as it were. Well, perhaps in another way, in that it encourages you to overcome that struggle within yourself at the same time, and so there's a kind of attitude that's helpful. That's reflected in the ability to just, and the encouragement of just getting your book out there.
I didn't really get the second point, but the first point I totally agree with. And the idea of being able to publish early and often was definitely part of what I liked. So with Leanpub, there is the idea of, you know, publishing sort of before you're finished. I really liked that idea, sort of give people a chance to try it out and see what they like and then keep going. And I knew when I was contemplating this idea that I wanted to sort of continuously update it forever, but I didn't know exactly what form that would take. And it's very easy. The way Leanpub does it is very easy for me. I don't have to deal with anything, essentially.
Great. So
I love that.
When you first click the publish button, how finished were you? Was your book in your mind? I mean, were all the chapters there? But there was more improvement you wanted to do, or?
Yeah, I did have all the chapters, but several of them were pretty sketchy. And there's still a piece that I'm not totally sure about. I have a couple things where I don't know where to fit them. And so I still have those things sort of sitting out there. But yeah, I would say maybe it was like, you know, 60% done or something like that. And I would say now I decided, you know, it's artificial in the sense I don't have to push a print button or anything. Mm-hmm. I've decided that now it's release ready, although it definitely isn't something I could print. I still have four or five places where I say to do, to remind myself
great.
To go in here and put this thing in.
Yeah. Great. No, that's one of we've seen authors using Leanpub for that. And I personally really like the sort of straightforwardness of that. And actually as a reader, that would draw me in, an author being that straightforward, that this is something left to do and don't worry, you'll get it when it's done.
Right.
I was wondering a very specific technical question. So Leanpub books are written in Markdown. And I was wondering if you'd ever used Markdown before you came to Leanpub.
No, I had not. But it's really quick to pick up, and I like it. One of the things, so that goes to my philosophy versus personality. My philosophy is very much with the agile software development. Keep it simple. If you have to cut features, fine. And I like that. But my mentality is also, I want it to be exactly how I want it to be. I get frustrated with it isn't so much true today, but like 10 years ago, you would use like a word processing program and it wouldn't do what you wanted it to do. And you couldn't like go in and see the code and just make a little change very easily.
Right.
Or if you're using a visual HTML editor. Mm-hmm, so and I would just go in and see the HTML itself and make it do exactly what I wanted.
I see.
With Markdown, the biggest limitation I've had, and it's not huge, but it's the only thing that really caused me any frustration, is there are places where I would like to be able to be more specific about what it does exactly. And it's like, well, Markdown just isn't specific enough to do that right now.
Can you give me an example of that?
This isn't a perfect example because it's dependent on other variables, but you can link from, you can put in a link to another part in the book. And the way that gets done currently in Leanpub for a PDF generated document, it puts it below the title. So if you link to the section on PDSA cycle,
right,
it puts it below the PDSA cycle. So all you see is text.
Right. Instead of seeing the title of the section, actually. Yeah,
exactly.
That's something that's been on our backlog for quite some time. So this is definitely a big vote in favor of getting to making that fix. So thanks for that.
Yeah. And so it's like, that's one that I can remember, but there are a couple things that were sort of, putting in a white space was another that I've had difficulty with. And I've sort of come up with some things that seem to work most of the time. But it basically, I think what I do is I fake that like I'm going to have a black text and then it's just blank and that will throw in some white space.
Right. I see. That's clever. Another little Markdown trick we've sometimes seen people use is an empty table. So you just put two pipes with nothing in between them and then you'll actually get a blank line. But thanks for that. That's one of the limitations in Markdown that we've had people ask about from time to time. And for us, it's always a very difficult thing because partly we don't want people to be, in a way, we want to have some limits on features out of principle, because we don't want authors to be spending too much time worrying about formatting. So in other words, we don't want to invent, when you were describing earlier, you know, that the sort of, you know, troubles one can have working with these vast, complex, text editors. I mean, I'm sympathetic. I've spent a lot of time shouting at my computer when I'm using Word. And for us, it's really we're totally open to adding features. But it's something for us. It's like a big it's a philosophical thing when we do it, because that's something that's we deem is more important than spending that time thinking about your writing. Is that piece of formatting. So thanks for that. I was wondering, if you think back to the when you were actually importing your blog, did that work well for you, or were there any weaknesses or things we could improve in that part of the process?
I forget totally, but I think it worked very well. I can't remember whether there were some things that I went and had to manually deal with or not.
Well, that's good, because if it had been too bad, I'm sure you would have remembered something.
I remember I remember there was something where I think maybe at the time it had trouble with if you had a more tag in. I remember a bunch of my posts ended up being clipped, and I think it might have been where I had a more, so that it, you know, sort of separated the post into what would be displayed and what would be the total post.
Actually,
but I can't remember if that was it or not.
Well, you probably may have, because that's a known sort of limitation of that we have with importing. And we've actually, because of people like you telling us about this, we actually added some wording to that import page where we explain that, you know, if your blog has settings with something like this more or read more kind of links, it means that it's only showing our import or partial posts. So the solution to that is unfortunately kind of not something we can really do on our end, but we are trying to make that part of the process a bit
for me
more
it
transparent.
Didn't matter, because I was drastically editing everything, so it was simple for me when I ran into those to just pull in text. So
I wanted to ask you about our variable pricing feature, the sliders on our purchase page. Have you been using that? Have you been experimenting with your minimum and suggested prices, or?
I have not been experimenting, but I've been using. I like it. I think it's a cool idea. And so I use it. So I have it set right now for $5 as the minimum price someone can pay, and $15 for the suggested price. And people pick prices all the way around. And for me, I would much rather have people reading my book. And the pricing matters much less to me than that. Now, at the same time, I think if it's just totally free, basically, I want people reading my book.
Mm-hmm.
Getting my book or downloading my book, I don't care about. I care if they read it. If I could, you know, if there were 1,000 people in Nigeria that said they wanted the book and didn't have any money to pay me, I'd be perfectly happy to have them, have them get the book.
So
on that
topic,
having a bunch of people get it that don't read it, I'm not interested.
On that topic, and I totally understand. On that topic, is there anything that Leanpub could do to help you market your book more, or spread the message about your book in a better way, or is that
probably
something you mostly want to do on your own? Okay.
I just don't know. My opinion of myself on management and process improvement is very high. My opinion of myself on marketing is very low.
Okay.
I don't even know what are the foolish things that I don't do. my guess is there's probably stuff that would be useful, but I don't even know what many of those things probably are.
Okay.
Yeah,
our approach towards that is we'd like to ask everybody if there's anything we can do to help them, so we understand the challenges better. But it's mostly, start a blog, which obviously you've had for a long time now, and tweet about it.
Right.
Those if one's doing those two things, and using coupons to send out free or discounted copies of books to potential reviewers and, you know, potentially influential readers, are things that we encourage. Have you been using coupons for your book?
Yeah. Yeah, and I like that. I've used it for, you know, friends and stuff to give them the opportunity to get the book. And also, like you say, for people who might review the book or people I know who have blogs on the topic who, you know, might be interested and might review the book.
Okay.
So, yeah, I've been doing that.
Okay. Just before we sign off on the interview, I was wondering if there's any final thing you'd like to take the opportunity to say either about the subject in your book or about Leanpub?
There should be, but I can't really think of anything off the top of my head.
Okay. That's about it for me then. John, thank you very much for being on the Lean Publishing Podcast and for being a Leanpub author.
Great. Thanks a lot.
Okay.